Welcome, everybody, to this week's session of the Islamic Manuscripts and Texts Colloquium. That's run by the Invisible East Research Program here at Oxford. And so this week we'll be continuing the focus of the previous weeks and this whole Michaelmas term on letters. So today it's my pleasure to introduce Maya Walravens, so a PhD candidate in the history department at the University of Antwerp. And her research broadly focuses on pre-modern Islamic diplomatic history and epistolography with a particular focus on the Bahmani Sultanate of medieval India. Her presentation today is titled Letters from the Bahmani Sultanate, circa 1450 to 1480. So as usual, we'll have a kind of 45-minute presentation given by Maya, and then we might take a short break, and then we'll get into looking more closely at some texts that Maya has pre-circulated. So I'll put the link to that pre-circulated text in the chat. Without further ado, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, Tommy. I will start straight away and share my screen. What I will be doing today is I will take you a bit further south into the Indian subcontinent, more specifically to the Bahmani Sultanate. What I want to do is just to give you an idea of the kind of epistolary sources that we have for this time and region, to show you how they look like, and also to think a bit about the challenges of using these sources and about how we can use them as historians. So the Bahmani Sultanate was a sultanate in central India between 1347 and 1528. On the map, you can see the extent of the Sultanate in the 14th century when it obtained independence from the Turluk dynasty of the Delhi Sultanates. In the 15th century, it expanded significantly and covered almost the complete Deccan region. To its north, the political landscape was rather fragmented, and we find a number of other Islamic states such as Gujarat, Malwa, Jampur, Bengal. And to its south lay the Hindu kingdom of Vijayanagara. On both sides, the Bahmanis frequently had to fight to settle some territorial disputes. It was not because of any external threats, however, that the Bahmani Sultanate eventually ceased to exist in the 16th century, but because of internal uprisings that led to it gradually falling apart from the 1480s onwards. And it fell apart into five new sultanates, which we know today as the Deccan Sultanates. And so by 1527, approximately, the Bahmani Sultanate did not exist anymore. The Bahmani Sultanate was a cosmopolitan Islamic state, and it shared a lot of characteristics with Islamic states in Iran and Central Asia. Some of those characteristics were just the natural outcome of history and the result of the expansion of Islam into South Asia. But others, the Bahmanis seem to have taken over more consciously from, for example, the Timurid dynasty, which they thought was some sort of example to emulate. That meant in first instance that the court and the administration of the Bahmanis were using Persian as the primary language. And as far as official correspondence is concerned, to a lesser extent, they were also using Arabic. And officials and administrators would generally be well-versed in Persian as a language, but also in the knowledge that was circulated through Persian texts. And I would also know a lot about the attitudes and the behaviors and tastes that were recommended in Persian literature. As far as the administrative offices of the Bahmani Sultanate are concerned, however, there are only very few primary sources that could tell us something about how the official documents of the Bahmanis looked, so their structure and layout, the formulae used, or the conventions in general used in documents. So only a few, less than 10 original chancery documents have been published in this publication by Khan, Sitapati, and Naeem, with transcriptions and with English summaries and also with photographic copies. They are not letters in the strict sense of the word. They are mostly land grants, orders to officials, rulings about local disputes. But I believe, as is common in this kind of Persian documents in the 15th century, they do often have sort of letter-like structure. We are more fortunate as far as literary collections are concerned. So these are also called Insha collections or Munsha'at. So these are works that an author pieced together by arranging a number of shorter texts, mainly letters, but they could basically be any kind of text. So by arranging them in one work, one after the other, with often a general introduction at the beginning of the work and a sort of subheadings before every new letter that is included. So there are two Bahmani letter collections available today. One is Riyad al-Insha by Mahmoud Gharan, and the other one is Kanz al-Ma'ani by Abdelkarim Nimdi. Mahmoud Gharan was probably the most important political figure in the Bahmani Sultanate in the second half of the 15th century. So he was born around 1411 in Gilan, which was an independent region south of the Caspian Sea. He was born into a family of rank, but we know very little about his early life. We just know that at some point he started to travel, that he was in Cairo in 1439, and later also in Syria, probably to study. In the 1450s, then he arrived in India, and he accepts a position at the Bahmani court. And eventually he would serve four successive sultans and carry different official titles. The last two of the sultans that he served were still children when they came to the throne. So in those years, Mahmoud Gharan also acted as regent, which means that he was basically the most powerful person in the sultanate. But then in 1481, he was killed on orders of the Sultan. Besides politics, he was also important in a number of other areas, such as trade. We know that he had agents trading on his behalf as far as the Ottoman lands, for example. He was also an important patron of architecture. There is a very famous madrasa that he had constructed in Bidar, which was the Bahmani capital in the 15th century. And of course, his heritage in literature is also important. So next to this Insha collection, he also wrote an Insha manual, which is quite well known, and which is entitled Manazir al-Insha. I will not discuss Manazir al-Insha here any further today, but it's certainly a valuable source for anyone who's interested in letter writing in the 15th century. Nimdihi was Mahmoud Gharan's secretary. And so he collected letters by both himself and by Mahmoud Gharan in this collection, Kanz al-Ma'ani. They are all different ones from the ones in Riyad al-Insha. So we have quite a large corpus of letters here. Like Mahmoud Gharan, Nimdihi had quite an eventful life with a lot of traveling involved across the Arabian Sea. He studied in Shiraz, probably, but then went to India, first sought employment in the Sultanate of Malwa, but then he ended up in the Bahmani Sultanate. And after Mahmud Ghafran's death, he also worked in Gujarat, where he then also composed a general history. For these two collections, Riyad al-Nashr and Kanz al-Marani, it's almost never clear if the letters that are included are copies of real letters that were at some point actually sent, or if they are perhaps copies, but with certain modifications. And then it's also not clear what exactly has been changed in comparison to the original letter, because the original is never preserved. Or they could, of course, also be just examples that are completely invented just for the purpose of including them in the collection as illustrations of beautiful and good letter writing. In some Mamluk collections, so then I'm speaking about the Mamluk Sultanate in Egypt and Syria, and not the Mamluk dynasty of the Delhi Sultanate, but so in some Mamluk collections, the headings to letters can contain information about the original letter. So for example, the size of the paper that the original letter was written on, or the kind of paper that was used, or the ink that was used, and often also the date that the original letter was sent. So in these cases, there's more certainty that these letters are in the Ishaq collections are copies of real letters, but we do not have that certainty for the Bahmani collections. So we always have to be careful when using them to reconstruct historical events, but that's an issue that I will come back to later. Both collections have been edited, and you can see here just a random page from the published edition of Riyad al-Nashr. So the editions are very helpful. They make our lives a lot easier, but it's also always worthwhile to also look at the manuscripts. At this point, we know of two existing manuscripts of Kanz al-Marani and more than 27 of Riyad al-Nashr. And something that becomes clear from looking at these different manuscripts that is not directly evident, I think, when you work with the editions alone, is that these Inshaq collections are not static texts, but that they are very versatile in a number of ways. So first of all, Riyad al-Nashr was a work that traveled a lot. So here you can see the list of its 27 manuscripts that you can find in Story's famous biographical survey of Persian literature. And you can immediately see that the manuscripts are a bit dispersed everywhere. So for Europe, for example, there is the Catalogue of Blochet, which is, of course, the Bibliothèque Nationale de France. Flügel and Kraft are catalogues of libraries in Vienna. Also in Europe is, of course, Leiden. In the UK, we have Rieu for the British Museum. IONET are the India Office Library, and all of these manuscripts are, of course, today in the British Library. There's also Cambridge and the Bodleian Libraries in Oxford. A couple of manuscripts in Russia as well. In India itself, there is the Asafia Library in Hyderabad, but also Bombay or today Mumbai, Madras or today Chennai. And for the Arabic world, there is Cairo listed. But this list in Story is already not exhaustive anymore today. So in Europe, for example, I've also seen a manuscript in Leipzig. And absent from the list are, of course, also the Iranian libraries and the Turkish libraries, There are several copies in the Majlis library in Tehran, at least one copy in Mashhad in the Imam-e-Reza library, and I think also at least one copy in the Sulaymaniyah library. Most of these manuscripts are unstudied, but the sheer number of them makes clear, I think, that was a very popular work, and they must also have been the kind of text that kept a certain relevance to different audiences in different and every time new historical circumstances. And I think that this popularity of Riyad al-Inshaa can be explained to some extent by the fact that it was also a very flexible text internally. So very few of its many, many manuscripts are exactly the same in their contents. And the most significant differences are in the order and the number of the letters. So the published edition of Riyad al-Inshaa has 148 letters, and the published edition of Kanz al-Marani has 137. But most manuscripts have much less. The order of the letters also differs between manuscripts. For example, here you can see the end of the introduction in one of the manuscripts of Riyad al-Inshaa in the Majlis library. And so in red ink, you can see the subheading or the title to the first letter that is included. And this letter is actually the letter that we know as letter number 3 from the published edition. And this is a very common thing to find. So not only the first letter, but also all the other letters in any manuscript can be arranged in any possible order. I do not think that this is the result alone of letters being lost in the process of copying or of manuscripts remaining unfinished. But I actually think, or it seems, that copyists had the freedom to select the letters that they felt were relevant for their purposes and, well, do their own thing with these manuscripts of Riyad al-Inshaa. Another element in the Bahman al-Inshaa collections that is a bit unsteady or inconsistent are the headings to the individual letters. So on first sight, they are very helpful. They are most of the time written in a different color, mostly in red. This is a very common thing in Islamic manuscripts in general. They allow you to skim through the manuscripts very quickly to see where one letter ends and the other one begins. And of course, they also give you very concisely some information already about the sender and the addressee. In non-Bahmani letter collections, for example, in Timurid collections, the headings often tend to be a bit less descriptive. For example, you will often find that it simply says Mektub Edigar or another letter without any more specifications. But in the Bahmani collections, there most of the time always something of substance that is written. Although it also depends on which manuscript that you have in front of you. That does not mean, though, that these headings can always be trusted. They can, in fact, make things more confusing, especially when there are significant variations between manuscripts. So, for example, you can see here the beginning of the same letter in the two manuscript copies that we have of Kanz al-Marani. And so it's the same letter, but the heading in the first one reads Mima Kutiba ila janib janab wazir al-wazir al-mushir min amir al-Mekka wal-Medina al-Musharrafa. And in the second one, it reads Min Qawl al-Mardum Khwaja al-Jahan ila Sultan al-Azim Sultan al-Arab al-Ajim Sultan Masr Khalada Allah Sultanahu wa Adlahu. So it's differently formulated, but it's also a different content here. So the first one says that the letter was written to the wazir, and we can suppose that this is the wazir of the Bahmani Sultanate, so Mahmud Ghafan. So from the wazir, to the wazir, min from the emir of Mecca and Medina. While the second one is min Khaja al-Jahan, and Khaja al-Jahan was another title of Mahmud Ghafan, one of the titles by which he was well known also outside of the Bahmani Sultanate. So this one is from Mahmud Ghafan to the Sultan of Masr, so the Sultan of Egypt. So the direction of the letter is reversed, and also one time we find that the non-Bahmani correspondent is the Amir of Mecca and Medina, and the other time it's the Sultan of Egypt. So on top of these differences, it's also quite common to find that actually the information in the heading, be it about the sender of the or the addressee, is not repeated in the letter itself. So we have to find other ways to get to know a bit more, to get a bit more certainty about to whom and from whom these letters actually are. So that brings me to how we can use these letters in historical research. Very often it's a challenge already to get the basic historical questions right of who, what, when, where, how. So we need to place these letters in their proper historical context. That's something that already came up as well in the previous presentations, and it's something that is important for every kind of letter, because otherwise you just are reading completely disconnected fragments of texts. But it is especially important for letters in Shia collections because they come with this extra set of questions about their authenticity. So again, these are not real documentary sources, but copies of documents in literary sources, and any original letters, if they ever existed, have been lost. At least they all have for the Bahmani collections. One strategy to deal with this question of authenticity is to go looking for matching letters in Shia collections, other in Shia collections that were composed in the environment of any addressees. So for example, in the Ottoman collection by Feridun Bey, there is one Bahmani letter included that is also part of Riyad al-Insha, together with the Ottoman answer. So this suggests very strongly that the Bahmani letter was at some point actually sent to the Ottomans, received by the Ottomans, and then also answered by the Ottomans. But to be very honest, this strategy does not work for most of the other letters in the Bahmani collections. I have tried, I've been looking all over in other collections, mainly Timurid ones, and I did not find any other letters that could be straightforwardly matched to any letter in the Bahmani collections. So I think that the best way still to deal with questions of context and authenticity is to first just read the letter very closely, compare manuscripts if something is not clear, and then consult also contemporary historiographical books and biographical dictionaries, for example, to see if the puzzle fits. And as an example of how that goes in practice for the Bahmani letters, I show you here a part of the same letter with the confusing headings from the previous slide. And so in this case, we're actually lucky that the letter does name the addressee. So in the first manuscript, his name is Pashang. This is also the version that you will find in the published edition of Kanzel Marani, because it's based on this one manuscript alone. So I went looking for this person named Pashank. I couldn't find any. So then I went looking at the second manuscript, and there the name is a bit different. It's written Beshbek. That still didn't really ring a bell. I couldn't find anyone named Beshbek, either in the Mamluk sources or in the South Asian sources. But because of the fact that I had two versions of the name and the dots seemed to be a bit flexible, the placement of the dots apparently describes themselves, had made changes to them through the process of copying. So then I thought this looks actually very much like a name that is much more common in the Mamluk Sultanate, which is Yeshbek. And Yeshbek Min Mahdi was at the time that I suppose the letter was written, in the second half of the 15th century, so approximately between the 1460s and the 1480s. Yeshbek Min Mahdi was actually one of the highest officials in the Mamluk Sultanate. So that would make sense. And it would also mean that both of the headings were not completely right. So Yeshbek Min Mahdi is not the Amir of Mecca and Medina, is also not the Sultan of Egypt. But still, we have here a Mamluk official. So it's, if you have other suggestions, I would be happy to hear them. But I think this letter was probably written to Yeshbek Min Mahdi. As another example, this is the end of letter number 134 in the published edition of Riyad al-Inshaa. It's also a letter to Egypt. The heading says that this is a letter to the Sultan of Egypt, but the letter itself does not contain a lot of specific information. It's actually a very typical Persian letter. Sorry, it's in Arabic, but it's typical in style for this kind of epistolary writing in the 15th century. It has a lot of flowery language that is used mainly to express certain emotions and to evoke a certain atmosphere. And in this case, it just wants to express the cordial relations that existed between the Bahmanis and Egypt. And the only more concrete piece of information in the letter says that in order to further these friendly relations, a man is sent who is called Al-Hafiz Ubaidallah. So it was my only lead to actually discover a bit more about the context of this letter. But Al-Hafiz Ubaidallah is not known from any South Asian sources, as far as I could check. So then I went to the most obvious place in the Mamluk sources, and that is actually the biographical dictionary of As-Sakhawi. And a bit to my own surprise, I found him in the dictionary indeed. And I was even happier to discover that what As-Sakhawi writes fits actually very well with a letter to Egypt. So he writes that Ubaidallah al-Hafiz came to Cairo at some point, but then left again to take up service to go work into the service of Malik al-Tujar. And Malik al-Tujar is another famous title of Mahmud Ghafan, by which he was known kind of internationally. He entered the service of Mahmud Ghafan, but then returned to Cairo more than once, so Rayer Mara several times, with presents. So when reading this, I think we can very easily imagine that the letter in Riyad al-Inshaa is the kind of letter that would also have accompanied the presence that an agent or an envoy as Ubaydallah al-Hafiz would be carrying from the Bahmani Sultanate to the Mamluk Sultan. Then a final direction of research or something else that we can look into that can help us to better understand these letters is document structure, including formulae, rules, conventions of letter writing that these letters might display. This is a field in itself, but I think that for anyone working with pre-modern Islamic letters, it's useful to look into it a little bit just to know what to expect when you are reading new letters. As an example here, you can see I've just selected one letter in yet another manuscript, this time one of Riyad al-Inshaa in Leiden. So this is the beginning of a letter from the Sultan, the Bahmani Sultan, to the Sultan of Gujarat. And it has this very common structure in the beginning of Hamdallah. So Alhamdulillah, and then a bit further on, it will say prayers and peace upon the Prophet. So As-salat wa salam ala nabihi. So that's also so a very common way to open a letter, and then would be followed by greetings and then the actual content of the letter. I will not go into more detail about that here, but I can point out a couple of things also about the structure of the letter that we will be reading in the second part of the session after the break. As a last thing then, I just wanted to be a bit more specific about how all of that translates in the research that I'm doing now on the basis of the Bahmani letters. So I've been contextualizing a lot of these letters, looking into their possible authenticity. Because I was originally interested in the diplomatic relations of the Bahmani Sultanate, we already know a couple of things about Bahmani diplomacy from several publications, most importantly, the famous works of Harun Khan Sherwani, who wrote several books on Mahmud Ghavan and the Bahmani Sultanate. But the information on diplomacy in there mostly focuses on the Bahmani relations with its immediate neighboring powers. So the, for example, Gujarat and Vijayanagara. There's much less in the literature generally about Islamic, about Bahmani relations with other Islamic powers outside of the Indian subcontinent. An exception is this article by Jean Aubin titled Les Relations diplomatiques entre les Akhoyunde et les Bahmanites of 1971, which is obviously on the Bahmani's relations with the Akhoyunde, among others, with this famous Uzun Hassan, who you can see pictured here, or at least you can see a statue of him. Modern statue of him pictured here, which stands today in Ashgabat in Turkmenistan. Another exception in the literature is this article by Stefan Pop on Persische diplomatische correspondence. And he discusses in it several letters from Riyad al-Inshaa that are interesting from a diplomatic point of view, so as related to diplomacy. And I felt that there is still much more material in Riyad al-Inshaa and in Kanza Ma'ani that could be looked at in relation to international or inter-trans-regional diplomacy. So I focused on the Bahmanis' relations with the Mamluk Sultanate in Egypt and Syria, with the Ottomans. Then we have, of course, the Turkmen confederations in the middle, and then with the Timurids in the east. But I soon realized that there is a very good reason that not much has been written yet on Bahmani diplomacy with these powers. And that is that the letters do not lend themselves very well to a kind of traditional diplomatic history. So I mean that there are, for example, no conflicts that are described. There are no military victories proclaimed. There is hardly anything official in these letters that needs to be resolved or communicated. So very often we do not have a lot of very concrete content or stories about concrete historical events taking place in the relations between these powers in the Bahmani letters. So, and I think part of the reason for that is probably simply that the Bahmani Sultanate did not share any borders with these powers, and they just had very few conflicts. And when we think of diplomatic history, then we quickly think of the kind of exchanges that took place in contexts of war and well, fighting and stuff. But where it became interesting for me then is first when I started to contextualize these letters, and I got all these extra little pieces of information at least. But then also I think when I started seeing these collections as a whole. So what I did in the beginning, and what most people, I think, most people that work on Inshaya collections do, is that they select the letters that fit within their interests and that they think can answer the questions that they are asking. For example, as Jean Aubin did with the letters to the Akuyundu, so he just selected all the letters to the Akuyundu and then examined them. But I think we should not forget that these Inshaya collections are not just a bunch of letters that happen to end up together in a collection, but they are very personal and careful selections. And as such, they're also a unique window into a person's life from different angles and from angles that you can almost never find in any other type of sources. And as a consequence, I believe that you cannot fully understand the official relations with also looking at the personal ones. I think that this is a distinction that is more something that, that this is a more modern distinction, a distinction that we make today, dividing things between official and personal. But in the pre-modern Islamic world, this kind of relations often went hand in hand. And therefore, I'm also looking at Mahmoud Ghaffan's intellectual network, among others, his contacts with this man here, Ali Shir Nawawi, who is a famous Timurid statesman. And so he also has a letter that was to him in Kanz al-Ma'ani, I believe. So I look at Mahmoud Ghaffan's intellectual networks, but also at his family networks and at the kind of agents such as Ubayd al-Hafiz, who we saw just earlier. So that's something that I forgot to mention, but these letter collections, these Bahmani letter collections, the letters in there are really addressed to a large variety of addressees. So we have sultans and officials working in different sultanates, but we also have these family members of Mahmoud Ghaffan and then a lot of intellectuals and Sufis, for example, and others, and also people that we haven't been able to identify with a lot of certainty yet. So now my research is more about how these personal networks influenced relations on a state and trans-regional level. I'm writing all of that up in my thesis at the moment, and I hope to be able to publish more results in the coming years. But in the meantime, I'm very interested to hear any comments, thoughts, and questions that you might have before we go on to the second part of the session. So that's it for now, and thank you very much.